Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Back Talk. I am your host, Lucas Gravesu, and I'm joined today by the BWO superstar, the Puerto Rican Prince. How are you doing, Prince?
I'm doing fantastic. How about you?
That's great. I'm doing good as well. Quarantined because of the coronavirus.
This sucks. But we only have a few more days of it. Less than a week.
Supposedly.
Supposedly, yes, of course. Supposedly, there is the 15-day rule, so once we get to next Tuesday, at least for, you know, you and I, because we've been quarantining since...
For about a week now.
Yeah, roundabout. Because Monday is when it started, so 15 days from then would be next Tuesday.
Yeah. Tuesday coming up, I guess. So a week from tomorrow. Nope, whatever, I don't know.
A week from yesterday.
I can think coherently. Anyway, this podcast is about wrestling, so we should probably talk about wrestling. WrestleMania is coming up, it's around the corner here.
It's actually today.
Oh, yes. Of course, because they're pre-recording it this year.
Now you want to hear something even more interesting.
Let's hear it.
Yesterday, they pre-recorded the SmackDown and Raw after WrestleMania.
Yeah.
Today, they're recording WrestleMania.
Of course. Because, you know, that makes perfect sense.
So that means the people... So let's go with the fact that what we really hope is that Drew McIntyre wins, right?
Yeah.
He had to go out there with the WWE Championship and pretend like he won the match. He had to describe things in said match that have not happened yet.
Yep.
So he had to go out there and go, oh, I Claymore kicked his head off, and like kind of look around and go, wait, so now I got to do this move during the match now. So that's really interesting.
WWE is just in shambles, really, at this point. Like, I don't even understand.
Yeah, I was just really confused because I'm like, I understand pre-recording. Like, I totally get that.
Yeah.
I'm there. I get it. But why was it necessary to pre-record the Raw and SmackDown after before? Like, why wouldn't you just do WrestleMania yesterday?
Yeah. Or just Raw, like, after. Like, it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, it doesn't make any sense. I feel so bad for Drew McIntyre.
I feel bad for all of them, because, I mean, they worked hard all year to get to Mania, and now they're just kind of,
like,
getting the short end of the stick.
Like, all of the guys... Most of them, again, except, like, Angel Garza, this is his first Mania,
right,
and a few other guys. But, like, Drew was told he was going to be the guy, was fired,
yeah,
won a world championship at Impact, carried that company for a while, came back, won the NXT title, won the Royal Rumble in one of the biggest pops I've ever heard, like,
yeah,
recently. And now he's being told, yeah, you get to win the WWE title, but you get no pop behind it.
Yeah, I feel bad for all of them, really. I mean, it's just...
I agree with you. It sucks.
Speaking of things that make no sense, WrestleMania is now two nights. It's two nights this year. So that's great.
And... Two nights. Like, my inherent issue with it being two nights. Because I agree. Because Wrestle Kingdom did two nights. And it was perfect.
Well, Wrestle Kingdom also had a large sum of good matches that I wanted to watch.
Exactly. The problem is when we look at WrestleMania, like, Wrestle Kingdom, most of those matches, if they went over 20 minutes, I'm cool. I'm there. I'll watch it. That's why they were able to split into two nights. If they make me sit through a Roman Goldberg 20-minute match, I'm going to cry.
Especially without fans. Like, what?
Like, no, literally, it's going to be both them looking at each other. Like, I could already imagine their pre-match, like, conversation.
Yeah.
Roman was like, well, I could scream, I could punch you, I could pick you up and Samoan drop you, and I can spear you.
Yeah.
And then Goldberg was like, well, I could scream, I could punch you, I could pick you up for a jackhammer, and I could spear you. And then they looked at each other and realized they have about, probably, obviously more than those moves. They probably have 15 moves in their arsenal together. Yeah. And they're like, the whole match is just going to be spear, kick out, jackhammer, kick out, jackhammer, kick out, spear, kick out, spear, kick out, spear, 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 Roman wins.
Yep.
Which is so bad.
But granted, it would be fine if there were, like, fans and everyone could, like,
yes,
and it was interesting.
And there aren't, like, and I'll admit, this WrestleMania looks to be one of the better ones in recent memory, like, on the actual card itself.
Yeah, but it's not going to be.
No, because It's just, they're giving me good matches. The issue is, and this is the issue that happened last year, they're not going to set anything up after. So, for an example, Drew is set. Drew probably has the best storyline right now. He wins. There is, like, a myriad of guys on Raw that could face him. Kevin Owens, Seth Rollins, Samoa Joe.
Right.
Andrade.
A bunch of guys.
Yeah, there's a bunch of dudes, not including NXT call-ups, right, that could happen. Roman, on the other hand, what do you do? Do you go face The Fiend? Because you're in a worse position. Because then if you make The Fiend lose, you've jobbed The Fiend officially.
To Roman Reigns.
And if you have Roman win, what was the point of having Roman win at Mania?
Right. Why not just have Fiend Goldberg?
Precisely. And then, like, maybe... like, again, the only way I could see them going on SmackDown is Braun.
Yeah, maybe.
I'm cool with Braun winning, honestly, because Braun deserves it, but, like, he's the only one. Maybe, like, Shinsuke or like, but, Daniel Bryan. Like,
but it's like it's a push. It's a heavy push to get those
guys. Yeah, exactly. Like, if you're saying, like, Daniel Bryan's going to go from, like, being a tag team, like, lately, being a tag team championship and mid-card wrestler,
right,
which is fine. That he likes that. Again, as much as people are like, oh, he should be pushed harder. No, he's asking for that because he wants to work with guys like Gulak and Sami Zayn.
Because he wants to work with the people who are actually good at wrestling and not the people who just get pushed because they are cool or whatever WWE
exactly
likes to call
it. Like, he's tired of facing guys like, you know, like
Roman.
Like Roman. Like, yeah, exactly. He's like, no, I don't want to. I'm going to face Kofi Kingston at WrestleMania and give you probably what was, you know, the main roster match of the year, maybe besides Rollins and Brock, but, like, dear God.
Yeah.
But the two-night thing, I half agree with and I half disagree with, so.
Yeah. So, anyway, the Bleacher Report has put out a thing saying basically how they believe the nights are going to be split up with all the matches. On night one is, we have the Universal Championship match. We've already talked about that. I don't think we really need to hit on that again. They also have the Raw Women's Championship match. Becky Lynch versus Shayna. Which is supposedly the main event of that night. Which will be interesting.
Becky and Shayna?
Supposedly.
Why?
I mean, would you rather have Goldberg versus Roman be the main event?
At least, again... I understand what the issue is. I understand that it's going to be a bad match. But, on the other hand, they need to be like, it needs to feel important. Again, I'll give them both credit where credit is due. The promos they've been cutting lately are fantastic.
Yeah.
Roman has done an amazing job saying, you know, dude, I got booed every day for, like, 3 years, and I still came to work and did my job and did it well.
Right.
So don't tell me now that you could just roll in here, pick up a title whenever you choose, because you're just here for a payday. And he's speaking the truth.
He's right,
and
yeah.
I like that. But I can't imagine that not being in the main event. Again, I love Shayna. Shayna is probably my favorite female wrestler right now in WWE, at least.
No, Becky's character is just too good.
I love Becky. Believe me, I love Becky. But the role that Shayna is on right now, I want Shayna to, like, beat her bad.
Yeah.
I want it to be a squash. Because they say that Becky wants some time off after this, which is cool.
It's definitely Becky's time to call it on the championship. It was very cool for the past, like, year and a half, the whole man thing. It was very cool. But it's time. Like, it's time to call it.
Let Shayna absolutely destroy her, and then let Shayna run roughshod on everyone in the women's division for the next year.
Until Ronda comes back.
Until Ronda or Becky comes back.
Oh,
I don't care.
Imagine a triple threat between those two.
That'd be fantastic. that match would be very similar to the Daniel Bryan match, where you have, like, two people who are kind of a tag team beating down on the babyface until the babyface eventually gets the win.
Yeah. Also, is Bray Wyatt versus John Cena. Now, as much as I want to hate on this match, there is an interesting rumor going around that there's going to be some kind of, like, weird stipulation, House of Horrors kind of thing going on with this match.
The House of Horrors was so bad.
It was bad, but I think it could be improved upon. It could be.
I will admit.
It could become better.
Randy Orton was not the guy.
No.
Randy Orton was not the guy. Randy Orton does not play the role of scared well. John Cena, I'll admit, the last time Bray Wyatt and him feuded, he did scared really well.
Yeah, that match at Mania 30, I believe it was.
It was awesome.
It was great.
It's fantastic. But yeah, I'm just like, I'm not mad. If Cena does it right, if Cena makes it the whole time, like, he's actually, like, gonna cry because he's so scared.
Yeah, but if he does what Orton did and just kind of looks, like, generally confused about what's happening.
Yeah, that was the problem, is Orton made it look goofy.
No, like, here's the real problem, is that there was, like, a 30 to 45 minute break in between, like, House of Horrors part and the in-ring part. So there was, like, two jobber matches in between, and then Randy Orton came back on, and I was just like, why am I watching this now? Like, why is this on my screen again?
Yes. It was terrible. And again, the Bray Wyatt kind of made up for it because they at least acknowledged the fact that it was goofy and then, like, played it up, but, like, kind of, like, made it better when they did the Hardy version of it.
Yeah.
They at least made it funny then, so, like, they were like, haha, it's not that serious. So I would prefer if they just did it normally in the ring, but on the other hand, it's hard to make The Fiend look scary without the crowd, you know, without the crowd, you know, playing a big part in it.
Yeah.
Without, you know, the lights being everywhere. So if they do a House of Horrors match, at least if they make it look good, then I'm fine.
Yeah. The next match on night one of WrestleMania is the Women's Tag Team Championship match, which is the Kabuki Warriors versus Alexa Bliss and Nikki Cross. Please, God, do something else with the tag team championships.
What?
Like, they need to stop doing this feud. It's not doing it for me.
And this is what they need to do so bad. Okay. Keep the belts of the Kabuki Warriors. Keep it.
Because they're the only tag team. They're the only actual tag team in the women's division right now.
Yes. Keep the belts on them. Have Alexa Bliss turn on Nikki Cross. And have Alexa Bliss go face whoever wins that six-pack SmackDown Women's Championship match.
Yep.
Because Alexa Bliss is one of your best performers, and you have continually... And this might be on her own accord, because she might be taking a break. I don't know. But they need to make her champion again, because that SmackDown Women's Division is horrendous, and I blame it on Bayley because Bayley's not interesting, and Alexa Bliss needs to go in there and be like, all right, I'm done. My turn.
Yeah.
And bring that division back. Because actually, the SmackDown Women's Division has a lot of depth to it. Hence, they're doing a, you know, six-pack challenge.
Right.
But Alexa Bliss needs that title. Have her turn on Nikki. Have her beat Nikki in a feud. And then have Alexa Bliss go off and be SmackDown Women's Champion again.
I'd be fine with that. Because last time Alexa Bliss was champion, the women's division was very good. The whole feud with Bayley with the kendo stick on a pole match, that was great.
Yes, and even her when she cashed in the Money in the Bank on Ronda.
Yeah.
I give Alexa Bliss the total credit of making Ronda legitimate.
Yeah. Because Ronda just threw her around the ring.
Yes, and Alexa took it. Yep. She was like, nah, throw me around. I'm the heel.
Yeah.
Like, Alexa Bliss in her career has put so many people over as stars. Becky is one. Ronda's one. Nia Jax is one. Nia Jax was nothing before they had that bullying feud with Alexa Bliss. And Alexa Bliss really played that mean girl role really well.
Speaking about Nia Jax, she's rumored to be coming back soon. Should be cool.
Yes.
That'd be cool.
Let that happen. I like Nia Jax. And Alexa Bliss, whoever wants, if we don't want to admit it, it's fine. But she put Braun Strowman over.
Yeah.
When they were in the Mixed Match Challenge. Again, Braun was over before that, but then this was his point where he was, like, at his lowest. Like, WWE had given up on him, and Alexa Bliss was like, no, like, she elevated him.
Right, so. Yeah.
Dude, let her do her thing.
She's good at what she does.
She is good at what she does. That's why she got moved to SmackDown.
Yep.
And they just haven't used her.
Yep. And the next match is another tag team match, but this one is for the Raw Tag Team Championships. With the Street Profits versus...
Could this match be anywhere racist?
versus Andrade and Angel Garza.
Like, I can name like five tag teams in the Raw locker room that could be facing the Street Profits right now. And you told, and you were like, hey, Angel and Andrade, you're both Mexican, right? And they were like, yeah, I guess. And he goes, all right, I'm going to need y'all to be a tag team now. But Vince, I have the United States title. Wouldn't that be weird to tell people that I have two? No, I don't care. No, I have no care. You both are Mexican. You're both going to tag team. Is that understood? God. Yes, sir. It's what was that? Yes, senor. Okay. Because Vince is racist.
He is. It's not
There's a million other tag teams. Nobody can tell me any different. There's like five other tag teams in that whole locker room. Or an NXT that could move up and face the Street Profits. But you are forcing Andrade and Angel Garza.
Oh my god.
And if they win, I'm just lost.
Like, I don't even know what's going on anymore if they win.
Like, they can't win. They cannot win. There's no way that you can have Andrade hold two belts. I love Andrade, and he's great, but like...
But he's not that good.
No, and Angel Garza's... And again, Angel Garza's not... I would have loved this. I would have loved Angel Garza get mad that Andrade came back and go... And he should have gone for the United States title.
Yeah. That would have been fine. I would have enjoyed that.
Angel Garza's a very talented wrestler, and if they would just let him and Andrade feud, but, like, no, they're making him a tag team because he's racist, because Vince is racist.
Anyway, moving on to the non-title matches of Night 1, the first one being Kevin Owens versus Seth Rollins. I think this is very interesting, what they're doing with this feud, because there's so many different ways that they could have it, like, pan out in the end.
Yeah, agreed.
Where they're having, like, Buddy turn on Seth, or having, like, KO join them or something like that. It's very interesting. Yeah. The next one is Otis versus Dolph Ziggler, and I'm crying inside because this is such a stupid idea.
And I like Otis, too, because Otis is funny as hell. Like, he's actually hilarious.
But keep him in the tag team. He's not a singles wrestler.
No! And, like, they're trying to take advantage of the fact that he's, like, halfway over right now, the whole Mandy Rose thing. And, again, that storyline is funny, but, like, again, that is a perfect example of a feud that only works with a crowd.
Yep.
Because, again, it would be like having Orange Cassidy in a ring with no crowd. Like, the whole point of the match that makes it funny is the fact that the crowd is going, yeah, Otis! And everyone's, like, doing, like, yes chants for him and stuff. Like, that's what makes Otis funny, is that he's so over with the crowd.
Right.
But when you just put him in a ring and just let him wrestle and have him win, like, with no pop, it's going to make it really awkward.
Yeah, it's just going to be dumb. It's like, why am I watching this match in the supposed biggest show that WWE has to offer?
Exactly. This is a match that should be happening on, like, an Extreme Rules or Elimination Chamber card.
Or at least make it on, like, the pre-show. Like, come on.
Yes, I agree.
And the last match of the first night is Aleister Black versus Bobby Lashley. And Bobby Lashley needs to not have a head when this match is over. Like, it really just needs to happen.
Oh, God, Bobby. I remember, like, 3 years ago, 2 years ago, when Roman and Lesnar got done with their match at Mania, and Lesnar won, and I was like, Bobby Lashley, and the big rumor was Bobby Lashley. He did come back on that Raw. We were all like, yes, Bobby Lashley's coming back. Let's go.
Yeah.
He's going to beat Brock. And then and then Bobby beat Roman, and everyone was like, oh my God. Like, he's legit.
Yeah. And then he jobbed to Sami Zayn.
Yeah.
Oh, and don't forget the whole Rusev feud. That was something else. Oh, dear. Anyway, moving on to night two of WrestleMania is the other big men's championship match, Brock Lesnar versus Drew McIntyre, which is going to be, obviously, the main event of the second night.
Yeah, it's probably going to be a good match.
Is there, like, even the chance that Lesnar wins this match at this point? Like,
there's a chance with everything. There's a chance Goldberg wins, because I thought there was a chance he was going to beat The Fiend. So, in all seriousness, I'm done watching WWE if Goldberg beats The Fiend. I mean, beats Roman Reigns. No, because here's the reason why. And I was actually discussing this with my dad the other day. I said that about when Goldberg beat The Fiend, I wasn't going to watch WWE. But I now understand what the purpose was for that.
Yeah.
It was to get Roman over.
Mm-hmm.
They have done
WWE has done countless things to get Roman over. It's actually ridiculous.
And again, I've swallowed it all like an enormous pill, and I'm taking it. Whatever. This is the only win I've ever wanted Roman Reigns to get.
Like, Goldberg needs God, to does retire. Not beat
Goldberg at Mania.
Oh my God.
Done. Because then there's nobody, and I'm fully and completely done. If you, oh my God, I can't.
I can't even like imagine it.
No, I don't want to.
Goldberg but like sucks. But that in all fairness, I said I couldn't even imagine The Fiend losing to Goldberg.
Yeah.
So you know, I don't know anymore. I'm at a loss. I'm at a complete and total loss.
Agreed.
The next match, the other Royal Rumble winners match, Rhea Ripley versus Charlotte Flair. This one could go either way, in my opinion.
That's a good match.
Yeah, it's going to be a great match. It could go either way. Rhea could win and shock everyone, or Charlotte could win and go back to NXT, which I think would be great for her character.
I agree. I have no problem with either.
Yeah.
I'm cool with either. That's one of the matches. That's one of the rare matches on the night that I'm either winning. And I'm just going to watch it for pure wrestling enjoyment.
Yeah. Also, the build-up has been great. All the feuds on NXT and on Raw.
Yeah, they've done a great job with this feud in particular. They've clearly taken a liking to Rhea Ripley. So, mm-hmm. Hey, you know, she's not my favorite women's wrestler in the whole world, but guess what? As long as you're, you know, enhancing NXT talent and you're giving them the spotlight they deserve, I can't complain.
Yeah. Plus, it'll be a great match. So, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm all for it.
Exactly. Like, it's just good wrestling.
Yeah. Isn't that what we really want at the end of the day?
Exactly.
Moving on to the next and possibly worst match of the card, AJ Styles versus The Undertaker in a Boneyard. What is a Boneyard match?
I don't know.
Like, what is it, like a House of Horrors kind of concept, or is it like, what are
we? I don't know. I thought that, like my thing is that AJ came out there and made it like everyone knew what this was, and I'm like, do you mean a Buried Alive match? Because that's the Undertaker's signature match. Or a casket match, because he does that quite frequently at WrestleMania. But I don't know what a Boneyard match is.
Like, what?
And I'm telling you right now, this is the dumbest idea WWE has done in a while. Because AJ Styles versus Undertaker is not going to be a great match on its own. But AJ could carry him through a match.
Yeah.
But why now are you going to put stipulations on it that the Undertaker can't take a bump? He can't.
Or give one. He struggled to choke slam him.
Twice! Once in Saudi Arabia and once on Raw. He can't choke slam people anymore.
Because he's like 208 years old and should retire already.
Okay, I swear, AJ needs to go over in this match.
Speaking of AJ, that promo was phenomenal.
Oh, every single one he's done like lately has been, it's been amazing.
Anyway. The SmackDown next is the SmackDown Women's Championship 6-Pack Challenge Elimination Match. They throw any more stipulations on this match, I don't know what's going to happen. Is Sasha Banks basically just winning this match now? Is that what we're going with? Because it's either going to be Bayley or Sasha.
I think it's going to be Tamina.
Or Natalya, maybe? I don't know.
Natalya's not in the match.
Yes, she is.
She is?
I'm pretty sure. Oh, no, it's Dana Brooke, not Natalya.
Oh, no.
Because, you know, we love Dana Brooke.
Please let Sasha win. And then build to a Sasha Bayley match at Money in the Bank.
Oh, that'd be great. That'd be phenomenal.
That's fantastic. See, that's good booking, because then you're like, okay, I have a match now for later, you know?
Yep, but Vince isn't that smart, so, you know, who knows what we're going to get. Anyway, next is the SmackDown Tag Team Championship match, which hasn't actually been confirmed who's quite going in there yet. We have Miz and Morrison versus either the New Day or the Usos. I think that match is on Friday.
Who cares?
Yeah.
Who cares? I don't care who wins this.
I don't. I hope the New Day or the Usos win, just because I don't like Miz and Morrison.
Dude, I was so mad that they've done this to Morrison, because Morrison could have easily gone to NXT.
Oh, that would have been... Imagine him versus Dream, dude. Oh, my God.
Imagine versus Adam Cole, baby. Like, do you know how good that would be?
But no, he's on the main roster teaming with The Miz.
In the tag team division. Like, why? There's no need.
Oh, God. Now on to the non-title matches. We have a last man standing match between Edge and Randy Orton.
I think these two are going to do some crazy stuff.
I think they're going to do some crazy stuff, but I don't really care. Like, I didn't care as nearly as much as I thought I was going to about this match.
Yeah, it does seem like not...
Because the build-up's been terrible. They've done the same thing for 5 weeks in a row now.
Well, that's the problem, is that it started hot. Like, so when Orton beat him, and he did the promo and everything, and then Edge disappeared, so they did everything well.
But they had him beat up Matt Hardy for some reason.
Yeah, that was the issue, is that they keep now, like... I wish that there's something missing here, and I don't know what the key ingredient is.
The authority. The authority was the key ingredient, because heel Orton on his own is terrible.
Yeah, he's just, and again, no, I actually disagree with that. I think that Orton as a heel, as like, just, I'm going to beat you, and I'm going to bloody you and everything, I think that's perfect for him. And I do think his promos have been very good lately. But after Orton came out and hit MVP.
Yeah.
That should have been the go-home to WrestleMania.
Yep.
Now it's like every week this thing is getting drawn out, and all we want to see is a bloodbath.
Like, it's just stupid at this point. I hope Edge wins, because I'm a big Edge guy. But
yeah, I hope you have Edge win. I don't see why you wouldn't, honestly.
Yeah. Like, have him go out winning.
Yeah. Not even go out, because he's signed for like 3 years now. But like, yeah, make him like a legitimate contender for a championship.
Yeah. If he's 100% cleared to go, have him go all the way. Might as well.
Yeah, let him go win a title. I'm fine with it. Yeah. Like, again, he's one of those, like, part-timers that I'm cool with, like, winning a championship.
It's not like it's Undertaker where he's 50 and can't do anything anymore.
Exactly.
He can actually do moves now, which is great. The other fantastic non-title match is Elias versus Baron Corbin. And this is, I didn't think this was possible, but this is somehow worse than the Roman versus Baron Corbin feud. Like, I don't understand why this is happening, especially at WrestleMania.
Because there's no story. The story is that Elias is trolling Corbin all the time.
Elias doesn't work without fans. Elias is literally, there is no Elias without the WWE fans.
Exactly. It doesn't work. And again, Elias is funny, and he's very charismatic, and I like Elias, and I do really think he's good, and I do think he should win a championship. But he keeps, like, and I get it, and it is funny when he messes with Corbin, but, like, I don't know why it constitutes a match. Like,
especially at WrestleMania. Like, why is this happening? This is so dumb.
Yeah, it's like, I don't know. I do think this match is very, you know, it's one of those matches that's just not, doesn't look right on the card.
Right, yeah.
It doesn't look correct, so I'm like, okay, whatever. Let him fight, I guess.
Yeah. And then there is rumored to be, it's not confirmed yet, but there is supposedly an Intercontinental Championship match between Sami Zayn and Daniel Bryan.
That's good.
That's good. And this is exactly why Sami Zayn needs to be the Intercontinental Champion.
Yes!
It's because he can wrestle with anyone. He can literally wrestle with Roman Reigns, or he can wrestle with, I don't even know, Kurt Hawkins. Right. Like, he can wrestle with anyone. And it's a great match. I don't know why he hasn't been a champion up until this point.
Agreed.
But it's whatever.
But he's there now, so I'll take it.
Yeah. The other, moving away from WrestleMania, the other bit of WWE news is that apparently they're changing TakeOver. So now it's happening on like the weekly shows now.
That might be the dumbest decision they've done in a while.
Yeah, that's going to have to take the cake for me.
Because now I'm just not going to watch NXT.
Yeah.
Until the Velveteen Dreams match comes on.
Yep.
And that is the one time you'll get me to switch the channel for that one match. I won't even watch the rest of the episode. Seriously.
Yeah.
Like, I don't care enough about, like, maybe I'll watch Gargano and Ciampa. But even then, I'd rather watch that after.
Yeah, I'll watch that the day after when there's no wrestling.
Yeah, like, I don't... I'm not, I don't, like, none of the matches on TakeOver feel important enough where I'm like, I have, like, other than, again, other than the Velveteen Dream, because he's really good at his job, make me like, oh my god, I have to watch this live.
Right. Well, it's not even live, it's pre-recorded.
Yeah, exactly, right? like, Velveteen Dream's the only one that I'm like, yes, I need to see this.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not into it.
I'm not
it's
into
dumb.
It.
It's obviously a ploy to get more views away from AEW, but in reality, AEW
is just, it's just too good right now.
It's superior, because they don't...
It's like WCW, when WCW was really popular before it tanked.
Yes, except they're not using the NWO, like, you know, their version of the NWO is their circle, or the Elite, excessively. They have other factions in their organization that are, like, good. Like, they just came up with Death Triangle, which is Pac and the Lucha Bros.
That's just ridiculous. Like, that's just...
That's insane! Those are three of your greatest performers in a team, and they're great!
And they can all cut promos, which is the best part.
Yes,
that's something that WWE is lacking, is having tag teams that are able to cut promos and do things other than have mediocre matches.
Exactly. The Best Friends cut amazing promos. Death Triangle, the trio, cut amazing promos. The Young Bucks obviously cut amazing promos.
Chris Jericho and his group.
And Hangman. Yep. And I'm telling you, bro, when we get to this point, God, I hope this happens, and I'm praying to God that Kenny Omega and the Bucks turn heel.
Oh, that'd be phenomenal.
Bro, if they do that, like, they've... Because, again, NXT right now, because this is Triple H's problem, is, you know, they... Or WWE in general, they realize, like, oh, you know... If we're not getting this many views, then I don't really care about what I put up product, so I'll just put random matches together.
Yeah.
And that really messed them up, because then, guess who debuted last week?
Matthew Hardy.
Matt Hardy and Brody Lee.
His character is phenomenal. The promo that he cut was excellent.
Oh, Brody Lee was awesome. Where he goes, "You're not the first out-of-touch old guy to not believe in me." And I was like, yes!
That was phenomenal. Anyway, speaking of what we were just talking about, moving on to some news about AEW. Blood and Guts, the, what's it called, the pay-per-view that was recently, but was supposed to be happening, I think on March 31st, actually, was postponed until further notice due to the World War Z effect that we're having currently. I mean, yeah, I get it. I'm not, like, disappointed or anything. It's just annoying.
Yeah, but it's gonna happen.
Yeah, it's just annoying. Like, whatever.
Agreed.
AEW are phenomenal with having events with no fans.
Yep.
And WWE just aren't. They're just bad at it.
Yeah.
Which is why I'm gonna watch AEW instead of NXT every week.
Why wouldn't I? When they're, like, again, it's the little things that AEW does better. When all of a sudden I hear in the crowd from MJF during a Lucha Bros match, L-O, get O to the corner, O, Pentagon O.
Are you
And Pentagon just looks at him from the crowd, and it's just like, what did he just say? And then they did a whole bit where, Justin Roberts, I think, is in quarantine right now, so he wasn't able to be at the show.
Yeah.
And Brandi Rhodes, when she was in WWE, was an announcer, and it goes up, she's on the screen, and she's looking at the camera, shrugs her shoulders, and her little thing comes up and says, Brandi Rhodes, and then above it says, said she would never be an announcer again. Like, that's hilarious.
MJF was... he was gambling with one of, like, the announcers.
Yeah, he was gambling on everyone else. And then he got really mad when Tony Schiavone was like, are you gambling on wrestling? And he was like, oh, how dare you? Like, he's just funny. And they put the heels and the faces on opposite sides of the arena and let them do their thing.
And it's great. I wish WWE would do that, but they're not going to. So, you know.
Yeah, never. Because they're sticks in the mud.
Yep.
They don't like having fun.
Speaking of AEW and NXT, AEW, like, doubled NXT's ratings this week.
Bad!
horrible.
They had the best plan.
Yeah, NXT, I don't think NXT had any actual matches, did they?
They had, they didn't. They only had the promo. They re-ran something. I forgot what it was.
Yeah.
They re-ran an NXT event, and then they had the Tommaso Ciampa... Johnny Gargano what's it called, video package.
It's great. I mean, it's a great video package, but I don't want to just watch that on NXT.
It's very well produced. But who cares?
Yeah.
I think it was just absolutely just, this whole thing is creative. Like, WWE's handling this completely wrong. I actually think, I just pulled it up. My godfather texted me after.
Yeah.
The show, and he goes, I think we need to learn more about DIY on WWE. I think we jumped the shark when they showcased their blood type, social security number, and favorite childhood color on this week's NXT show.
That's funny.
And then he goes, one show has Brody Lee and Matt Hardy, while the other show has NXT, has Candice LeRae, home video recap.
That's funny.
Which is true, like, you, like, and AEW had the perfect, the alley-oop with the Brody Lee thing, everyone tuned in, and then Matt Hardy with the slam dunk.
That was hilarious. And what made the whole Matt Hardy thing, I don't know if you saw this or not, but Chris, there was the camera pans of Jericho when Matt Hardy appeared, and he mouthed Matt Hardy in, like, a surprised way, which just sold the whole thing perfectly.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, he really was like, oh, no.
I gotta say, Chris Jericho is doing very well for a man of his age in wrestling.
Oh, he's fantastic. Because this is what Jericho has done in the last, like, and this is why Jericho's, in my opinion, is the greatest wrestler of all time. And he's pretty irrefutably the best. When you look at what he's done in the last 5 years or so,
yeah,
he has taken it upon himself to put other guys over.
Yep.
He put Kenny Omega over. He put Tetsuya Naito over. He put Okada over more when he took the loss to Okada. He basically jobbed to everyone in New Japan.
And then he went to AEW.
Yeah, then he went to AEW, and he single-handedly put over Hangman Page's better babyfaces ever, like in AEW right now.
Yeah.
He put over Kenny Omega, even though he beat him.
And then he created a stable that are extremely over at the moment.
Yes, but with guys that nobody cared about. Nobody cared about Guevara. Nobody cared about Jake. Well, it could be Jake Hager might be the only one with a little bit of name. LAX was not LAX, technically. They are still Santana and Ortiz, so that's why they needed him.
Yeah.
He put Cody over as probably the biggest babyface in wrestling today.
Yep.
And he spotlighted guys in his, like, those little championship matches he'd have on Dynamite. He put over guys like Darby Allin and Jungle Boy.
Yeah.
He is inventing the new generation of wrestling so that when he steps away, there's this whole slew of people that are still there.
Which is great. Which is what you should do when you're old and then wrestling.
Exactly. Not doing what Undertaker's doing right now.
Oh,
just
God.
Beating people.
God. Okay. So that is it for wrestling news today. However, we have another segment that we are going to cover now. The Puerto Rican Prince here has come up with his list of the top 50 wrestlers. Is it of all time or at the moment?
All time.
His top 50 wrestlers of all time. Let's hear it. What do you got so far?
So, if there's a name on this list you do not know, ask me. Because I was extremely bored during quarantine.
I was very bored after like 2 days, and it's been like and it's been like 8 days now, so like I'm like really bored right now.
Agreed. So here's my list. So I'll go I'll like stop after every 10, and then you could like tell me a record.
Okay.
All right, so 50 to 40. 50, Mark Henry. 49, Kenta Kobayashi. 48, Booker T. 47, Goldberg. 46, Shinsuke Nakamura. 45, Ultimate Warrior. 44, Cody Rhodes. 43, Pedro Morales. 42, Christopher Daniels. 41, Rick Rude. And 40, Edge.
Can you repeat that a little slower so I can, like, process what you're saying?
All right. Number 50 is Mark Henry.
Yep.
Number 49 is Kenta Kobayashi.
Yep.
He invented the barbed wire match, like with the barbed wire around the ring.
Yeah.
And he was the first guy to rig explosives to a ring for a match. Oh, God. If you look up Kenta Kobayashi, there is some insane stuff. Like, he would rig explosives to the ring, to the barbed wire, so that when the guy would Irish whip him into it, it would explode like a bomb.
Wow.
So, yeah, he was insane. Booker T is my number 48, tag team, five-time world champ. But yep. He's low because, you know, he didn't really get pushed in WWE that hard.
And Harlem Heat were just phenomenal.
Yeah, and they're one of the better tag teams of all time.
Yeah.
Goldberg, I acknowledge what he's done for the business.
What has he done for the business?
He was a big cornerstone in WCW.
Oh, yay, because that company did really well.
I know, but I acknowledge what he did. That's why he's number 47.
Okay,
fair enough. 46, Shinsuke Nakamura. He was one of the three musketeers in New Japan.
I guess, but I mean, his WWE career surely tanked him.
No, exactly. That's why he's number 46 and not higher.
Okay.
Great, again, fantastic in New Japan. A lot of five-star matches. Invented a stable that's still there today, Chaos. Yeah. So,
fair enough.
And former NXT champion.
Yep.
45, Ultimate Warrior.
Yeah, I mean, I have
terrible wrestler, terrible person, important to the business.
But he's the Ultimate Warrior.
But he's the Ultimate Warrior. So, I acknowledge his presence. Cody Rhodes, number 44. Literally invented a company.
I don't know why he's not higher. It's because he's younger, hasn't done as much
yet. Yeah, that's basically why. It's because he's younger.
Yeah.
And he's still going. So, like, some of the guys on this list that are still going, I put them a little bit lower.
Just because they have more to do.
Yeah. Well, yeah, exactly. Cody Rhodes, I see that he could do more.
Yeah.
Pedro Morales, first Puerto Rican world champion. Very important to wrestling. Ran, basically, the independent circuit in Latin America for a while.
Yeah.
Fair enough. 42, Christopher Daniels, SCU, one of my favorite tag teams of all time.
They're very good. Around
forever. Carry TNA with AJ Styles. I mean,
I think TNA needs some carrying right now.
Yeah. 41, Rick Rude. Rick Rude was the first, like, he is the Velveteen Dream when being gay was not accepted.
I mean, fair enough.
It's true, and it was awesome, and that's why he inspired. I know he is a big cornerstone to guys like the Velveteen, guys like Shawn Michaels, who I know he was a big influence on them.
Yeah.
And then 40's Edge, for you know the Brood, for just
being Edge. I mean, Edge is just great.
Exactly. Multiple time Money in the Bank champion. Great matches. Great character.
Great.
39, Jushin Thunder Liger.
Yep. What hasn't he done for wrestling? I mean, really.
Yeah, exactly. The dude's literally competed everywhere.
I mean, he's even going into the WWE Hall of Fame this year, even though he only had like one match in WWE.
Against Tyler Breeze.
Oh, great! Yay.
But Tyler Breeze was good. He's probably the best junior heavyweight of all time. There's obviously a few other guys in that list, like Kota Ibushi is probably up there in that list. Osprey has made himself very well known in that division, but he's probably up there.
Yeah.
38, your favorite, Bruno Sammartino.
I disagree.
I have to acknowledge his...
No, I don't.
I
he wrestled four matches a year. I don't care.
I acknowledge that he was important to wrestling, and he was a big figure in, like, the 50s or 60s.
Yes, he's important to wrestling, but I'm going to quote CM Punk here. Yes, when you wrestle four matches a year, obviously you're going to be champion for 2,000 days.
I know. I'm not doing that just because of his title reign. I'm also doing it because he was a big inspiration to a lot of guys later. And again, it was, like, the 50s, so, like, I
compare it's like, okay, yeah, it's fair. It's like Bill Russell, I guess.
Exactly. He's my Bill Russell of the list. Then I forgot this guy, so I had to put him in. Number 37 and a half, Jerry Lawler.
Why?
Because Jerry Lawler
was certainly not in for, he's certainly not in there for wrestling.
Yes, he is.
Why?
Because he ran Memphis for a long time and had the first ever five-star match.
His commentary puts him off the list.
For just like a heads up for my list, I did not acknowledge managers. I did not put women wrestlers in this list. And I did not put managers, commentators, any of that crap. So that's why Jerry Lawler is number 37 and a half. Number 37, Gorgeous George. Like, who? the first wrestler ever. Like, wrestling was basically a circus act for, like...
Oh, right, yeah, I know now. I know who he is now.
He was the first guy to, like, legitimately, be a wrestler. Like, he came out with, a manager and, like, Sparkles.
The first, like, mainstream wrestler.
Yeah, exactly. So then my next one is Mil Máscaras, the first luchador in WWE. He basically popularized luchador wrestling in America. And he basically, like, ran, he was AAA. Like,
and his theme song AAA is very cool. Huh? And he has a cool theme song.
Yes. Yes. Number 35, Ivan Koloff. He is a good reason. He was Vince McMahon's perfect guy. I don't think he worked for WWE, but he was a Russian guy who would, you know, threaten people, and he was really tough. He did invent that foreign menace heel character.
Yeah.
34, RVD.
Rob Van Dam is phenomenal.
He's Rob Van Dam, dude. Like,
yeah.
Come on. Cornerstone of ECW, WWE champion.
And he still wrestles today. And he's like,
oh God, don't remind
he's
me
really
that.
Old.
That's why he's 34.
Yeah.
33 is the Iron Sheik.
Yeah.
I mean, he's the Iron Sheik. Again, same reason for Ivan Koloff, except he's more mainstream.
Yeah.
Ricky Steamboat's number 32.
I think Ricky Steamboat is very underrated for what he's done.
He's very, very underrated. That's why I put him at 32 ahead of all those other guys. Great matches with Randy Savage. Got really over. Had a unique look.
Yeah, he was definitely out there for back then.
Yeah, like coming out with like the dragon mask on and everything. Yeah. So, yeah, I just thought that was really cool. And then 31, Scott Hall, Razor Ramon.
I very much dislike Scott Hall, but I understand why. I very much understand.
I don't even like Kevin Nash.
I understand. I don't like any of them. The NWO was just not what it should have been. I get why he's on your list, and sure, fine, whatever. But I don't like Scott Hall.
Well, you'll be glad to know I did not put Kevin Nash on this list anywhere.
Thank God.
Not anywhere on this list. 30 is Sting.
Sting was good.
Sting, because, you know, his feud with Ric Flair, when he was colorful Sting, and then black and white Sting was
They
awesome.
Should not have had him lose at Mania.
They should not have had him lose at Mania, I agree, but he is WCW, so he had to lose.
Yeah, I guess. Whatever.
Rowdy Piper's number 29.
I also think he's kind of underrated.
I agree. Rowdy Piper is one of the greatest heels of all time, because he would, like, tell you this story of, like, yes, of course, he was a heel, and everyone hated him. But he would also do these, like, really cool things where, like, he was in this match with Bret Hart. Mm-hmm. And the ref gets knocked down. And Rowdy Piper goes for the ring bell. And he goes to hit Bret Hart with it. And in a split second, he looks at him. And then stops. And then goes to pick Bret up. Bret hits him with a move. 1, 2, 3. Wins. And yeah. It was awesome. And it told a story.
That's why I like wrestling back then, because it wasn't just this person versus this person. It told exactly. it told an actual story that I would have been like interested in hearing about.
Agreed. 28, Antonio Inoki.
Yeah.
I mean, dude invented New Japan Pro Wrestling.
It's got to be up there.
27, Kurt Angle.
He's not a good WWE performer, but he's a very good wrestler.
Oh, he's fantastic. Oh, my God. Some of the matches he put on were like...
With who was it? It was, God, I'm having a stupid moment. It was Brock and someone else. Who was it? The triple threat that everyone likes watching.
Oh, crap. Was it Triple H?
Yeah, it was Triple H. Triple H, Brock Lesnar, and Kurt Angle.
Yeah.
That was just a great match.
Yeah, exactly. And Kurt had an amazing feud with Shawn, and he was a funny character, and he embraced when the crowd hated him, so...
And he sucks, so you know.
And he sucks. 26, Kenny Omega.
Yeah.
I mean, he's Kenny Omega.
He's definitely he'll definitely be higher once his career is over.
Oh, agreed. Yes, that's why he's a little bit lower, but still in that, like, he could jump up to like my top 20. For now, he's number 26. But like, I mean, come on, dude. I mean,
the indie scene isn't what it is without Kenny Omega.
Oh, agreed. Yes, independent wrestling in general is not what it is with Kenny Omega. All right, so my next one.
Yep.
It is Rey Mysterio.
Okay.
I don't think that there's... Rey Mysterio is one of the greatest of all time. Probably the most famous masked wrestler ever.
Oh, easily.
Especially because he mainstreamed that in America, so that was an easy one.
Plus he fought all the big guys.
Yeah, exactly, and made it believable.
Yep.
24 is Terry Funk.
God.
Dude invented deathmatch wrestling.
That dude is insane. That dude is clinically insane.
Yeah, he was clinically insane. Oh, yeah. He would take the worst bumps in the world, and he has the first ever 5-star match. So, him and Jerry Lawler, that's why they're here.
Yep.
Harley Race, number 23. I just acknowledge what he did for the wrestling business. Big deal.
Fine.
Dusty Rhodes, 22.
Dusty Rhodes, he's done a lot for wrestling.
He's done a lot. Now, here's my most controversial one. I know I'm going to get a lot of backlash for this one, but it's true.
Yeah.
Chris Benoit.
Yeah.
21.
I don't know if he should be that high.
I put him this high because Chris Benoit has one of the greatest WrestleMania moments of all time.
Yes, okay, sure.
And he's the greatest technical wrestler that ever lived.
Yeah.
And he also traveled the world and, you know, and he made it. Because the difference between him and Shawn, because everyone likes to say, well, Chris Benoit wasn't the first short guy to succeed in the WWE. I was like, no, but you have to remember, Shawn's gimmick was that he was kind of goofy. Like, he was funny.
Yeah.
He'd walk around, and he'd shake around, and he'd kiss the girls in the crowd, and he would oversell everything, and that made him a good heel.
But Benoit was more of, like, the serious.
Yeah, he was serious, but he was still short, which was weird for the time, because nobody knew how to deal with that.
Yeah.
Because it almost wasn't believable, but it was, because he was big, and, you know, he was scary looking, and he was a good wrestler.
He was short, but he was, like, buff.
Oh, it's insane. Well, it took steroids, obviously.
Well, yes, but that's not the point.
Yeah. Number 20 is Mick Foley.
Speaking of people who have just done a crazy amount of things for wrestling.
Yeah, has, like, his brain is basically a mush ball at this point.
He's missing several body parts.
When you elect to get thrown off the steel cage through a table.
Yeah.
Then get back up.
And thrown off. Through the steel cage.
Thrown through. Then get back up. And get thrown on the thumbtacks. Or it might be thumbtacks off the cage and then through the cage. But whatever the order was, that happened all in one match.
Yeah.
Which was ridiculous.
And he lost.
Number 19 is Bret Hart.
Bret Hart's very good.
I mean, he would be higher, but he sucked in WCW.
I think we can just sum all of that up as WCW was just bad in general.
Agreed. other than the cruiserweights.
Well, that was different, kind of. That was kind of like its own thing.
Yeah, it was its own division, correct. There was no NWO in,
right.
In there.
Maybe that's why it was so good, you know?
Exactly. then 18, Eddie Guerrero.
Yeah. No, Eddie. No arguments here.
Another great mask. When he did wear a mask, he was really good. At a
arguably the best cruiserweight of all time.
Arguably, yeah. Him, Liger, Benoit.
Jericho. But, like, Jericho was only there for a little while.
Yeah, Jericho's another one. Kota Ibushi is another
Mysterio.
One.
He didn't really.
Rey Mysterio.
But Guerrero has, like, the cruiserweight recognition. Like, he's known to be, like, the cruiserweight guy.
Agreed, yes. Yeah, him and Mysterio with their matches at Halloween Havoc.
Yeah.
17, Randy Keith Orton.
Yeah, he's done.
He's Randy Orton.
He's been there since he was, like, 18, I think. Was it?
Oh, yeah, he's...
18
yeah,
or 19.
Something like that.
And he's, like, what, late 30s now?
Yep. And he's still going.
And he's still
putting
on
good matches. Put on good feuds. 16, Brock Lesnar.
Mm.
He He's put on great matches. Again,
he's put on great matches, but you also have to look at the several numbers of not great matches he's put on.
I know, I understand that, but I also acknowledge the fact that he's a big deal. I get it. He's a big deal in wrestling. He's a great character. He's one of the more believable characters, and he really does come off as the final boss.
The only reason I wouldn't put Lesnar this high, he's definitely on the list, I wouldn't put him this high, is because without Paul Heyman, he is nothing.
Okay, fair enough. I can agree with that. Number 15, Daniel Bryan.
Oh, he's done so much just for wrestling in general.
I mean, dude, he was probably one of the greatest independent wrestlers of all time. Basically, carried Ring of Honor alongside Omega in the early days. CM Punk, Samoa Joe.
Yeah, and then he had, in my opinion, the greatest WrestleMania moment of all time at WrestleMania 30.
Yep, when he made Batista tap, agreed. He's fantastic. One of the best baby faces of all time, and honestly, one of the best
His
heel run with Kofi was amazing.
It was great.
I mean, he took one of the biggest plot holes in wrestling's history of, you know, oh, but you said that, you know, you were the B-plus player. Why can't you give Kofi an opportunity? And he worked with it, and it was like, because I wasn't a B-plus player, you are.
Right.
Which was perfect. AJ Styles, number 14.
He's literally been everywhere and done everything.
Literally. I looked it up.
Yeah, I looked at AJ Styles' list of, like, championships that he's won. Yes. There's so many just, like, bizarre backstreet wrestling championships that AJ Styles has had.
And even mainstream ones. Dude's won a championship in New Japan, Impact, Ring of Honor, and WWE. That is unheard of.
Yeah.
That is, and NWA.
Yep.
That is insane. Number 13, probably the god of wrestling today, the greatest wrestler on the face of the earth today, Okada.
Yeah, I can get with that.
The dude's been on the top of the hill for like 5 years. It's just, I'm the greatest wrestler on the planet earth.
And he proves it time after time.
He's like, I put on more than 5-star matches with Kenny Omega. I have had tag team matches that are 5 stars. I have had 5-star matches with a lot of people.
Yeah.
I am a very good wrestler. So yes, Okada is 13. And he can move up. He will move up on the list as he gets older.
A lot of these younger people will. I like CM Punk. CM Punk is very good.
CM Punk, again, greatest promo of all time.
Yep, best microphone speaker of all time. I don't care what anyone else says.
Agreed.
You can throw the rock, and you can throw the rock in my face all you want to. I don't care.
Yeah. No, I agree with you. I think Punk. I agree with you on that. 11. And this is very hard to put him at 11. Randy Savage.
Yeah.
Big reason why WWE is the biggest company in the world today.
I mean, there's got to be someone big like that that's not in the top 10. So I mean, yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. And now here's my top 10. And I think the top 4 are irrefutable. You cannot argue them.
I bet I will argue them.
But the 10 through 5 is, you could argue. Number 10, Triple H.
Yeah, right. I think Triple H
number
is...
Number 9.
Hold on, for me, Triple H is only in the top 10. Yes, he was very good at wrestling, but he's only in the top 10 just because of what he does behind the scenes and with NXT.
I could agree with that as well.
Yeah.
I can agree with that as well. And what he did with DX, and he's a great wrestler, and he put a lot of guys over, and he really knows his stuff. So,
yeah.
Number 10 for me is Triple H. Number 9, The Undertaker.
Undertaker would be higher.
However,
had he retired 4 years ago.
Yeah. Number 8, and you're going to hate me for this, but it just has to be here. Hulk Hogan.
Yeah, I mean, he's definitely up there.
He made WWE what it is today. He made it the biggest company in the world, and he was an IWGP heavyweight champion at one point, as weird as that is to say.
Yeah, my only problem with guys like Hogan and guys like Stone Cold is they're great, but they're a character. They're not a wrestler. They're a character.
Back then, that's what it took.
See, that's why I will put Hulk Hogan in my top 10. Is because back then wrestling was like that, when you had Hulk Hogan versus The Rock, and you had Hulk Hogan versus Stone Cold, and just like crazy matches that told like a great story, but they were just bad wrestling.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. Speaking of him, Stone Cold comes in at number 7 for his significance and all that. But he drops to number 7 because the two guys above him, I think, are definitely arguably better. John Cena comes in at number 6.
Yeah. I would put him above who I think you're going to have at number 5. But
The Rock.
Yeah, I would put him above The Rock.
But him, The Rock, and John Cena are completely equal to each other, in my opinion, up until you get to the one thing, and that is tag team.
I don't care. Cena had a five-star match. I don't care.
I'm sorry, but I can't. I cannot say to you, you are over this person when you have not succeeded in a tag team and made an actual tag team legitimate. I can't, especially when it's like that close.
But he doesn't. He didn't need to. I don't think. I mean, he's tied for the most WWE World Championships of all time. And I'm gonna go ahead and assume he's going to break the tie before he retires.
Well, who knows at this point, but honestly, I don't see Cena as that number one guy just because of the fact that, like,
I get what you're saying with the tag team thing, but it's like, you're really just nitpicking at this point.
Well, I have to nitpick because they're so similar.
I guess. I mean, it doesn't really matter. Because they are, like you said, they're about the same.
Yeah, you could interchange them, and I would agree with you either way. But that's how I came down to is the tag. And then these four are irrefutable, in my opinion. Number 4, Hiroshi Tanahashi.
Yeah, he's definitely
carrying New Japan, like a bajillion time champion, literally does anything the company asks, carried that company. What more do you want from a wrestler?
I'll agree with you there.
Number 3 is Shawn Michaels. The greatest in-ring performer to ever live.
Oh, 100%.
Part of one of the greatest tag teams of all time.
Yep.
Succeeded in multiple generations. One of the greatest feuds of all time with The Undertaker.
He's just got it all, really.
He has it all. Number 2, Ric Flair.
See, here's my problem with Ric Flair is it's the same thing. He's a character.
Oh, I disagree with you there. I think Ric Flair surpassed that.
I don't.
Ric Flair has had like a bajillion 5-star matches, though.
Yes, I know that, but it was also back then when that was what wrestling was. If he wrestled those matches today, they'd be terrible.
Well, yeah, okay, that's fair. But no, but I actually disagree with you because Ric Flair had a lot of... He added to the matches. He added his own little thing to. So I think he could honestly... Again, young Ric Flair was able to elevate himself to whoever he needed to. So, like, whether it was Terry Funk, who was just insane.
I guess. I would put him at 4. I would put him with the other character guys.
And you would put Sean at 2?
Yep, I would go Sean, I would put him at 4.
All right, very well. I could agree with you there. And then number 1, as I mentioned before, is Chris Jericho.
Yeah.
Because Chris Jericho has done legitimately everything that you could ask.
Like, he's just done so many things.
Especially these last 10 years of his...
Even when he was, like, on and off with WWE, he was still... When he came back, he was still put on, like, great matches.
Oh, yeah, the one with Kevin Owens at Mania?
Yeah, and AJ.
And AJ, I forgot about that. Yeah. Yes. And Ambrose.
And Ambrose. That was a fun feud.
Yeah.
And the list. No one can forget the list.
See, that's the thing. Jericho reinvented himself so many times. He was the Lionheart, and then he was Y2J, and then he was, he's the first undisputed champion, and then he was...
And then he was shiny light-up jacket Chris Jericho.
Yeah. And then he was like, then he was him and Big Show, and then it was, and then it was the list, and then he was the Painmaker. And that was the Inner Circle.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Well, there's my top 50 list.
Yeah, I can get behind most of it. I'm not really, like, There's nothing like jumped out to me like I'm overly against any of those.
Obviously, other than Scott Hall, because you're not a because you hate the NWO and everything that WCW offered.
Yep. And Eric Bischoff. I don't like him either.
Oh my god, I hate him. I hate Eric Bischoff.
But he's back, so you know. He runs SmackDown. Maybe that's why SmackDown's so bad.
You're right.
God. Anyway, that concludes today's podcast episode. Hope everyone listening to this has a great day and stays safe during the current World War Z. Have a great day.